Let me welcome members to the 19th meeting in 2015 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, and of course, as usual, remind everyone to switch off mobile phones as they may affect the broadcasting system. We've received apologies from Mary Fee and her substitute, Mark Griffin. I congratulate on his fatherhood, which is why he's not here as substitute. And we've also received apologies from Fiona MacLeod and have Colin Keir substituting for her today. Agenda item one is for the committee to agree to take item three, which is an item for the committee to consider its work programme, to take that item in private. Do members agree to take agenda item three in private? We are agreed to take agenda item three in private. The second item for the committee today is to take evidence at stage one on the Lobbying Scotland Bill, and our first witness today is Bill Thomson, the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. Welcome to Bill, a familiar face of course for all sorts of reasons, and let me just kick off our questions, and perhaps if you want to make an initial statement, but my question will kind of lead to one anyway, just if you have general views on the bill that's been labelled and the implications for yourself in particular.
Thanks, Convener. I'm not going to express any views on the policy behind the bill. I have looked at it from the point of view of someone who may be asked to investigate complaints. I remain convinced of the importance of ensuring, so far as possible, that the requirements are clear, because where there is vagueness, then that may give rise to complaints, may make it very difficult to investigate complaints satisfactorily, and may lead me to reporting to you that something may or may not be a complaint. And I would prefer to avoid that position. I'm aware that the drafters of the bill have, so far as possible, in terms of the investigation and reporting procedure, followed those which are set out in the 2002 Act, which established the post which I now am in. I think in the application of that process to the regime under the bill, there is quite a risk of it becoming quite bureaucratic, which is time-consuming and, from my point of view, expensive. I don't think that's what the government are setting out to do in the bill, and I'm aware also that it could be ameliorated or moderated by the Parliament issuing to me directions under the powers which are in the bill, and there are specific areas where I think that might be helpful. If the committee are interested in the detail, I could run through a sort of a nightmare scenario which would involve four or five reports to the Parliament dealing with a single complaint, which just strikes me as a bit silly.
That would be extremely helpful, because I think it helps us get our mind round things if you can give us a, however unlikely it may be, a scenario that might play out in a way that is unhelpful to everybody.
I will do that. The other thing which troubles me slightly, and I have raised this before, is that at the moment, three of the types of complaint which I have to investigate may also be criminal offences. And under my existing powers, if I come across something which may be a criminal offence, I report immediately to the Procurator Fiscal, since obviously that is the system by which potential criminal offences are investigated. I can't see anything in the bill which would change that. In other words, quite a lot of the complaints which might come to me could be criminal offences. I would have to report them to the Fiscal. I am not clear what the Procurator Fiscal's or the Crown Office's attitude would be to dealing with those. At the very least, it would involve a bit of a delay in me being able to conclude an investigation. And as you will be aware from the bill, if I am unable to conclude the investigation within 6 months of the complaint being deemed admissible, I then have to report to you again. So that is just another risk. I'm not saying it will arise, but it could be quite clumsy. And therefore, it doesn't seem to me that the bill necessarily achieves the sort of light touch approach which I understand was the objective. And there's one point of self-interest. Paragraph 49 of the financial memorandum says that I am satisfied that any costs can be absorbed within my existing budget. That is not what I said. I don't know how it's ended up in that format in the financial memorandum. It just is not the position.
Just to address the issue, of course, the Finance Committee has written to us, I think, making precisely that point that there is a difference between what we've had from different parts of the system, and we will seek to address that. Let me also say that in a, it's the Members' Interest Bill, we're trying to get something from the Lord Advocate, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. We are seeking, in a different area in the Members' Interest Bill, to get something from the Lord Advocate that might help us in minimising the occasions where things automatically have to go to the Lord Advocate. And it would certainly seem on the face of it that this would be another case perhaps for ensuring that you're not placed in the position of having to refer everything, although it will be relatively evident that it won't lead to prosecution.
Okay.
So I suspect that may be the answer. But let me, it would be useful, you suggested that there would be an example where there might be five reports. And I think what your initial remarks have given us one report, an example of where a report would be derived that clearly is only prescribed administratively but would serve no useful purpose. Perhaps the other ones you have in your mind would be useful to hear.
With apologies, I'm inevitably going to have to go into an element of detail here.
Yes, please.
So if a complaint is received and it doesn't meet the conditions for admissibility set out in subsection 3 of section 23, and if it is of a sort identified in a direction from the Parliament, I have to report to you. For example, if the complaint isn't signed. In other words, these are formalities which may not be complied with. And I'm supposed to do that in terms of the bill before I consider whether or not the complaint warrants investigation, which is a second stage. So assuming I report, assuming I'm directed by, I presume, this committee of the Parliament to proceed with the complaint, I then have to look at whether or not it is worth investigating. If it merits investigation, I report again. So that's the second report within probably fairly quick succession on a single complaint. And then, as I've just mentioned, if because of, for example, overlap with the criminal system, there's a delay, there may not be a delay, but if there were to be a delay in those circumstances and it ran beyond 6 months, I would have to report again. Other possibilities are that the complaint is withdrawn. Then again, I would have to report to the committee. And whilst I appreciate the need for parliamentary oversight of the process, it does strike me that in that sort of situation, it's verging on overkill. And it is certainly bureaucratic. It takes up quite a lot of everybody's time.
Yes, I think that's quite helpful to spell that out, because it's sometimes on these bureaucratic issues that the integrity of the process can get compromised or appear to be compromised.
Can I just add, if the direction making powers which are given to the Parliament, I think it's under section 31, are used in a particular way, it would be possible to avoid the need for repeated reports in those sorts of circumstances. And I'm hoping that that is the position which we will reach.
I think, without necessarily taking the sense of my colleagues on the committee, we've listened to that point very carefully indeed. Just to be absolutely clear, it won't be this committee that determines the guidance that's given to yourself. We will recommend to Parliament who
indeed
will give it. Yeah. Just to be absolutely clear that we carry the responsibility for asking Parliament, but for not but we don't decide. To make clear that we've got that. Now, just one or two specific things. There's offences at section 21 about information notices and at section 42 with registration.
Yes.
And I suppose the question is just how well does that part of the bill work with your general power to investigate?
I'm not sure if I fully understand your question. I don't think there's any restriction on my power, my duty to investigate, other than, as I've already said, the possibility that something which is reported to me as a complaint could be criminal and therefore would have to be considered under the criminal prosecution system before I was able to do very much with it. There might be slight awkwardnesses there in terms of how much of the preliminary work I conduct under section 23 before deciding that something has to go to the Lord Advocate or the Procurator Fiscal, but I'm sure that detail can be worked out.
And similarly, and we're talking about perhaps the relatively minor mechanical things that may happen. I take it if the directions that you were to receive from Parliament ensured that you were able to return minor complaints to the clerks rather than dealing with them in the first instance yourself,
yeah,
that would not be a matter that would be likely, subject to the content of the direction, to cause you any concern.
It wouldn't, and actually, whilst I admit I hadn't until recently given this sufficient thought, I do think there is scope under subsection 2B of section 31 to set out circumstances in which certain types of relatively minor failures which could be dealt with by an information notice could be specified, and it would put me in the position where if that was the reason for the complaint, I would be able to refer it to the clerks to be dealt with under that procedure. I think that would be really helpful.
Certainly, I think at the core of our consideration of this whole issue has been all along that we don't want to create a punitive regime for small organisations in particular who lobby Parliament and quite properly do so, who perhaps have not got the same professional advice and people to know at the outset the rules and the opportunity for the clerks to interact with these organisations in the first instance and help and guide and advise before seeing if they fail to respond to that, in which case it would then land in your entry.
Can I suggest, and I hear I'm in danger of straying into policy, which I'm very wary of doing, but given my experience over more than 18 months now of investigating complaints of various sorts, one of the things which might be helpful would be some way of dealing with fairly minor issues without going through the full panoply. And I don't think that necessarily needs to be restricted to the smaller organisations which you're describing.
Yes. Yes.
Even a large organisation, if they've just missed out a detail, it seems unfortunate then to have to go through the whole potentially complex complaint procedure if there's a better way of dealing with it.
Right. Well, that's helpful. What I'm taking from that then is that if the directions from Parliament touched on that issue, that would not be a red line for you. You would look
at
the detail of the directions, and therefore it ought to be possible for us to come up with directions with which you would be comfortable in that regard. Now, that opens up the wider question of just whether you think the powers at Section 31 are sufficiently flexible for us to work out a proportionate regime that operates at a light touch where the issues are not huge and can be sorted out quite quickly, and still leaving you with the appropriate powers to deal with the more serious and recalcitrant people who might be part of this regime.
I think, Convener, They should be. I am by nature an optimist, and I see no reason why, given the right approach, that shouldn't be achieved.
I've not... David?
Yes?
Convener. Morning, Commissioner.
Morning.
I just have a general question I'd like to put to you. Your office and so on have been altered and changed in recent years, and you've been in the post now for 18 months. Are you confident that any additional workload that would come from an act following from this bill is capable of being absorbed into your current workload? Do you have sufficient resources? That's really the question.
I'm confident we will deal with it, but not without additional expenditure. And my confidence is based on an assumption that the number of complaints will be relatively low. I'm aware that the government's estimate of the potential number of registrants varies significantly from 255 to 10 times that number. I have assumed, for the purposes of estimation, that the number of complaints will not exceed a handful. The number of complaints which require to be investigated fully. Even if they don't, there will be extra costs. If they don't exceed that small number, then I think it will be manageable in terms of the resources available to me. And of course, we're speculating about what else happens in the future. If we were approaching nirvana, the number of other complaints I deal with would be reducing. I'm not certain that will happen.
Fisher?
Yeah, I mean, I think overall the idea of the bill is meant to be what's described as educative and light touch. And I think from what you've been saying, you think it still perhaps has a way to go to just ensure that that's absolutely the case.
That's correct. My experience of investigations is that they tend to lead to people, not surprisingly, becoming reasonably entrenched in their position and arguing their corner because somebody's investigating and therefore questioning what they have done and the propriety of it. And therefore I'm keen, as I detect certainly certain members of this committee are, to avoid having to go down a fairly formal investigative process if there are ways appropriately of dealing with issues that could be picked up by other means.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned in your introduction that you were concerned that some cases might have to, as things stand, be referred directly to the Procurator Fiscal. I think I understand the kind of scenario you're thinking of, but I wondered if, for the record, you might just like to tease that out a little bit.
Well, at the risk of being unduly simplistic, three of the offences, criminal offences under Section 42, are also matters which, on which complaints can be referred to me under Section 8, Subsection 1, Section 9, and Section 11 of the Bill. So on the face of it, any of those sorts of complaints would bring the risk that they could also be criminal.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can go into any more detail.
No, that's helpful.
Gil, it's catching your eye, Convener. When it comes to MSPs, Will, when there's a breach in registration, it's an automatic referral to the fiscal. And I know in some instances we've had, matters have been investigated by your own office, and what comes back, says it's such a minor thing. I know it doesn't actually say that, but reading between the lines. And I wondered, in this regard, you were talking earlier on, and what our colleagues raised with referrals to the Procurator Fiscal's office. Do you think, or would it cause you any embarrassment or problems if you had some discretion? After all, you would be looking at this in detail. and then maybe finding out, it could be referred, but because you've already investigated it, do you think that you should have discretion in minor breaches that it shouldn't be automatic, that you should maybe make a referral back to here and say, this is such a minor thing, we might be effectively wasting the fiscal's time and his resources?
I'm afraid that I'm a bit uncomfortable about that on grounds of principle, which is that I have no role at all, as you well know, in the system of criminal prosecution. And I fear that if I or any successor of mine were to have that sort of discretion, it could be seen as effectively usurping the role of the Crown Office, the Procurator Fiscal, in deciding whether or not a potential offence should be prosecuted. And I think that's actually quite a big... It may seem a trivial thing, and it may be that the particular issues we're talking about are very minor, but I think the principle is quite important. And at the very least, I would want to know what the attitude of the Crown Office was to that suggestion. It makes me a bit uncomfortable, perhaps because I have a legal background and I've just grown up with a particular approach to criminal law, but I certainly, as of now, would not be comfortable with that suggestion.
I may as well say it's a thought I always had, that trivial matters should be left with you, but the reason I then thought about it more, it might make you very uncomfortable for the very reasons, and it's good to get it on the record as far as I'm concerned. It puts my mind at ease. Okay. I came to that conclusion myself much later on, actually, so thanks for that.
Convener, it's not strictly part of this evidence session, therefore I don't wish to waste time on it, but there may be other circumstances in which, when you're looking at investigation and enforcement regimes generally, you do take account of the fact that others, for example, in relation to members' interests for political donations, which go to the Electoral Commission, have a range of approaches. I'm not arguing for those, but certainly on the point which has been raised, that there are different approaches.
I think that concludes the areas we wanted to cover with you, Bill. Is there anything further you wish to say to us?
Just elaborate slightly on a point I made at the beginning about certainty. And I'm looking at Schedule 1 of the bill, which identifies the types of communication which are not lobbying. The one which seemed to me a little bit problematic was set out in paragraph 5 and paragraph 6. And these are communications made in the course of a meeting or event arranged by or on behalf of a member of the parliament or a minister. And I'm conscious that there are frequent events arranged, usually of an evening, in this building, which are sponsored by members of the Parliament. I accept that some are done at the request of another individual and therefore would be covered by paragraph 6. But I wonder if it is right that any communication which takes place in the course of one of these events should be exempt from being lobbying, because it strikes me that if I were a lobbyist, I would regard these sorts of events as quite a good opportunity.
I think it would be fair to say that's one of the issues the committee will certainly be pursuing with the minister and considering in our discussions, because without her having taken a formal position, so I don't speak directly on behalf of the committee in saying this, it did seem to us that it was what actually happened that mattered rather than at whose initiative it was happening. And this is one of the areas that we will definitely be pursuing. So it's interesting that you've highlighted that to us, as indeed others have.
The other one which strikes me as slightly giving some potential for vagueness is the exemption for journalism, which isn't very well defined. And obviously there are all sorts of forms of journalism, I mean the types of publication, And certainly there are some which do at times adopt a line which could be thought of as lobbying. Some trade journals, for example, or professional journals. Mm-hmm. And I'm slightly concerned at the prospect of having to determine whether a communication which led to one of those publications was to be treated as journalism without any further explanation for what journalism actually means.
I think it's fair to say one of my regular purchases is Rail, which is a regular publication, and I think it would be fair to say the editor of that certainly uses his column to lobby government.
Yes.
So I think the point you make is a good
okay.
one.
Thank you.
Right.
I have nothing to add.
That's very helpful. And there's nothing else that my colleagues wish to ask. Thank you very much indeed for attending and being so helpful and fulsome in your
my
comments.
Pleasure. Thank
I
you.
Temporarily suspend while we change over witnesses. Right, our next witness is Joe FitzPatrick, the Minister for Parliamentary Business, and Joe is joined today by Al Gibson, who's the Bill Team Leader, Parliament and Legislation Unit, and Neil MacLeod, the Principal Legal Officer, Scottish Government Legal Department. Let me welcome you all to the meeting. We've got a number of areas we're going to ask questions on, and I'm going to kick off by throwing the baton to Cameron.
Sorry, I've quite got my papers here.
Sorry. Oh, I beg your pardon. Cameron, if we just wait a second, it gives you time. Minister, do you want to say some opening remarks to us?
Very briefly, I mean, I think, well, first of all, thank you very much, convener, and good morning, members. First of all, this bill is parliamentary in nature, and for that reason, in bringing it forward, we've been very keen from the outset to work closely with the committee in order to ensure that its views are reflected in the legislation that we are proposing. The committee's report in February was pivotal in helping to shape the bill that is now in front of you. Of the 17 recommendations in that report, 12 fell within the scope of the bill, and all of these have been reflected in whole or in part in our bill. Of course, we've consulted more widely in the spirit of seeking to achieve a broad consensus, and the bill attempts to pull in and reflect some of those views from stakeholders as well. Throughout the development of the bill, we have been guided by three underpinning principles. Firstly, that there cannot be any erosion of the Parliament's principles of openness, ease of access and accountability. Secondly, that the register of lobbyists must complement, not duplicate, existing transparency measures, and thirdly, that the new arrangements need to be proportionate, simple in their operation, and command broad support within and out with Parliament. Those principles, I think, have been broadly welcomed by all stakeholders and are at the heart of the bill that I have presented to Parliament. They continue to guide my thinking as the bill proceeds through its parliamentary stages. The bill in introduction seeks a balance between the interests of a wide range of stakeholders. It similarly seeks not to create unwelcome imbalances that could work against the Parliament's interests. Government will continue, of course, to listen to views on how to improve the bill, but I think it's important that any changes must still ensure that the register is proportionate, simple, and doesn't place an unnecessary burden on those seeking to engage with elected representatives. And the same is, of course, true in respect of meeting the committee's own firmly expressed views that the upkeep and oversight of the register should have very limited impact on the public purse. That said, I'm very pleased to take questions from committee members.
Thank you very much, and I will now go to Cameron.
Thank you very much. Morning, Minister. Thank you. I'm concerned that lobbyists wishing to conceal their identity surely will shift to other forms of communication, or that was the problem. If they want to conceal it, they might not reveal it. And also, if an NGO has paid employees and unpaid employees, would they not be able to switch these people around so the unpaid employees are not registered and the paid employees are? It's a double question.
Obviously, I watched the session last week, and there was a fair bit of discussion around that issue. So our approach has been to develop a framework which is proportionate and commands broad support, as I said. So we've had to form a view about what should be the trigger for registration, and like the committee, we wanted a proportionate system which increased transparency, but also one which does not discourage participative engagement. So our starting point was the same as the committee stated in paragraph 91 of your report, that lobbying activity, and I'm quoting, still places great value on face-to-face communications over emails, phone calls, or telecommunications of any kind. That was a conclusion that you came to after your evidence, and we thought it was an important starting point. I think that does strike the right balance, improving transparency without placing so great a burden on those seeking to engage with MSPs or ministers as to become a barrier. And in coming to that position, we've also tried to reflect further on the committee's report, where in paragraph 103, you recognise the ease of registering details of face-to-face meetings or events when compared to the prospect of registering details of all communications. You then follow that up in your report in paragraphs 107 and 109, leading, I think, to the conclusion in paragraph 111 of the committee's report, which lays out the committee's vision of a register which specifically refers to meetings that have been pre-arranged by the organisation and events, including meals, arranged by the organisation. So, convener, coming to a conclusion on where to draw the line, we were very mindful of the committee's extensive engagement in coming to your conclusions in your report. We're of course aware that there is a spectrum of views ranging from those who concur with the committee's previous report in the early years of the Parliament, which concluded that there was no need for any legislation in this area, to those who are lobbying quite effectively just now, I think, for a much more heavy-handed regime. We think the committee's proposals struck an appropriate balance, and that's largely been the basis of the bill that we have brought before you. I think to the specific point of shifting activity, whether it's from types of person or from types of lobbying or types of communication from face-to-face to email, I guess, is what you're implying. I think we need to remember the context for which this bill is coming forward. It's one in which I think we are all agreed that lobbying is deemed to be a positive contribution to our democratic process. So rather than being about probity, it's about transparency. So those lobbying, I would hope, will embrace that increased transparency as a good thing, that values their contribution towards our democratic processes rather than something they would try to avoid. We should also remember, I think, that the bill is part of a larger transparency framework that would almost certainly flag up if there was a shift of behaviour, as the question suggests, implies might happen. Then I think in those circumstances, it would the Parliament, I would have thought, would be wanting to look at the framework and look at whether changes needed to be made to strengthen the regime as appropriate. But right now, there is no indication that those involved in lobbying in the Scottish Parliament are seen in anything other than a positive light as contributing to the knowledge that we have, contributing to our work as MSPs, as ministers. And I see no reason why they would try to hide that activity in any way.
I wonder if I might just come in on the matter of our report, and in particular, Minister, take you to the first paragraph you referred to, which is paragraph 91, where I think we as a committee were seeking to make a distinction in that, in fact, more or less in what you quoted, but a distinction between what activities might be used to constitute a trigger for registration and what might thereafter appear in the register, which might encompass other activities beyond that activity used for registration. And I think you'll probably get a certain amount of questioning about the two appear to match. And if we go to one, I just want to specifically, since you referred to paragraphs at 111, we have very carefully used the word including. So I don't think in giving a list of what might appear in the register, we were seeking to exclude things that we didn't happen to have listed.
You're absolutely right. There is a difference between what might be a trigger and what might be recorded. And
I'll return the baton to Cameron.
No, I was wondering if people actually wanted to conceal things, if they really wanted to conceal their activity, and it is by emails, as you said. I mean, there's definitely an email rather than writing. How would we handle it? Have we put enough restraints on that, people who actually really do want to hide what they're doing? I change the, bring different people to the table or under different organisations, because certain organisations are quite similar on these sort of things.
I just don't think that there is that's not the framework in which we're in. That's not the atmosphere where we are with lobbying just now. And I think that the only danger of that becoming a problem would be if we were to bring in a framework which was onerous.
Yeah.
Then I think that there becomes a danger of people trying to avoid. I think if we can agree on it, and obviously we're going through a process here, so I'm still listening to the views that the committee will bring forward, but if we manage to maintain a proportionate, light touch, educative framework and regime, then I don't see the reason for anyone to try and avoid that, because lobbying is a good thing, it's positive, it's something we should be. It's something we're very proud of, is the engagement that we have with stakeholders of all sorts, it's something I think we value.
I would agree, and you don't think this will put people off? Is the way that with our light touch?
Well, I think as long as we maintain whatever changes happen to the bill going through, as long as we maintain a light touch regime, I would certainly hope that would not be the case. I see no reason for that. If the regime remains light touch, the stakeholders, even those stakeholders who feel quite strongly that there is no need for a regime because they have voluntary codes or they don't see a problem, feel that the regime that's been proposed by government and the proposal that came forward from the committee are both light touch enough that they think the case has been made by others and they're prepared to accept that and work with it. I think the danger would be if we bring in something which was onerous.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Maybe just before we move off that subject, Minister, if we were to extend the range of information that was required to be recorded in the register to include numbers of emails, letters, publications, and that is not intended to be a complete list. Do you think that would constitute a problem? And I say that in the context of not seeking for us to change the qualifying requirement, both for the registrant and perhaps to some extent you might be able to say in relation to the register itself.
Yeah, so there are significantly two significant different changes that could be made to include other communications. I noted last week when you were in discussion that you'd implied that it might be possible to include more communications without increasing the number of registrations. But and I think it would depend where a change was made. If a change was made to the trigger to include emails so that an email was a trigger, then I think that would significantly increase the number of people who would have to register. As an MSP, if you just look at your inbox, either by post or by email, the number of organisations that contact you on various issues that would then be caught as a trigger, most of whom you will not have any further engagement with, sometimes perhaps responding by email if that's deemed necessary. But I think that would be significant. The other point, of course, would be to include written communication which related to an already registrable event. So we already have a trigger in terms of a face-to-face meeting, and there may be communications around that, and clearly that would not increase the number of registrations as you've implied, but would potentially increase the amount of information that such a registrant would need to provide. So they are two different things. Whether that would put what we would need to be careful of is what how onerous that would be on the lobbyists to provide that level of information, and also how onerous that would be on the clerks of the Parliament in order to administer such a scheme going forward. So I think if we were to go down that route, we would need to tread carefully, I think, to make sure we weren't putting in a barrier that then said to people, well, actually, we're not going to engage anymore because this is just not worth it. So what we have done within the bill is provide a power in section 15 of the bill, which would allow a Parliament at a future date to do an inquiry into that, to specifically look, and this is absolutely a power for the Parliament, not for government, to look at whether that is an extension you would want to make to the regime and make such a change. So that power is already within the bill as it stands.
David has indicated. Now, Patricia wants to ask about the broadening of communications. Would it be appropriate to go Patricia first, David?
Yeah,
thank you.
Just as a general point, though, however, convener, I think it's actually quite important that we're very careful about language here, because engagement and lobbying are very different things. And it's lobbying we want to catch in the register, not engagement. So I think that's something that we all need to be very, very careful about. But I do wonder how it will be possible to capture or to demonstrate who initiated the contact. Is that something that has been thought about?
So we had to make a decision about how we could get to a point where we weren't making it difficult for MSPs and ministers to seek information from external sources that they deem to be important. So the aim here is not to hide anything. It's rather to preserve the ability for MSPs and ministers to get external third-party policy information without that person that you've asked to come in being then required to register. I suppose there's a degree of self-regulation in that the MSP or the minister would know if they'd initiated the meeting. One of the things to be clear is that there isn't a... If somebody, for instance, were to casually say, can you ask me for a meeting, that is still caught by the bill, because the third party has requested a request for a meeting, so it's still caught. So I think we've tried to draft this in a way to exclude any underhand ways of having a meeting requested, so that to make sure that we have maximum transparency of those meetings. Obviously, those sorts of meetings, if initiated by an MSP, would be covered by the ministerial proactive releases of such meetings. So we've tried to get. It's about trying to find a balance to make sure that we're not debarring and we're not making it more difficult for people to engage with MSPs and ministers and to block that access to information, factual information.
Just before I return the baton to Patricia, one of the things that's come up with me in the last 24 hours is that where someone is required to be in the register. There is a prescription as to what they register. In the case, as it's presently drafted, where the minister or MSP initiates the conversation for their benefit, it could well be that the lobbyist who's engaging in that wants to register the fact of that meeting. But it does appear, as the bill's drafted, that that isn't permitted. Only a voluntary registrant would appear to be able to register that. And I'm getting a sense that that's not the reading that officials have of that. And if that is the case, it would be helpful to get an indication that it would be perfectly possible for a registrant
I would hope so, but to, I'll ask
to be able to register additional information beyond that which is required, of which this would be only one example.
Yeah. Indeed, as you've noted, Convener, there is a provision for voluntary registration in Section 14 of the bill, but that is not what we're talking about here. In Section 7 of the bill, there's provision about additional information, and the general scheme here is where somebody is required to register, they register, and there is certain information that they must provide, but there is also the facility for them to provide additional information which the clerk can include in the register as they see fit.
Well, I think that's exactly the words which were causing some slight concern. That in other words, you have to persuade the clerk is the way it seems to read, if you want to, as the clerk may seem fit. I know it's probably just a legal construct, but it'd be very helpful just to have on the record that basically, subject to it being legal and not libelous and all these kind of tests that you would routinely apply, that you see it as entirely proper that a registrant would be able to submit additional information.
Indeed, the intention behind that provision is to allow the submission of additional information. It's necessary for the clerk to have some discretion, but certainly that is the intention. There is also, of course, in this bill the ability for the Parliament to issue guidance about the operation of this regime, and that is, for example, obviously a matter for the Parliament, but the sort of thing that guidance might properly...
Right, that's helpful. Patricia.
Yeah, I do actually wonder whether it actually matters who initiates the conversation. And I'm aware from the evidence we've had previously that in Canada they had a provision like that and they changed it after a few years because it was becoming seen as a loophole that allowed lobbyists to act without having to be without that having to be recorded.
We did look at the international situation in terms of such a provision, and there are 10 models that we are aware of, and there are only 3 of those that don't have that provision. So that provision is overwhelmingly considered to be appropriate. I think the only 3 that don't have, and I will be corrected by Al if I'm wrong, is United States of America, Canada and Slovenia, I think, are the only ones that don't have that provision. And I think the reason that provision is there is in order to make sure that we aren't making it more difficult for MSPs to go and say to an organisation, I need to pick your brains to get information about this question I'm going to ask to challenge, for opposition MSPs to challenge the government on an issue, for ministers to help develop policy. And you could see how if we don't have some way of accepting those type of contacts, then you could go and contact an organisation and say, could you please come and help me with this piece of work, this policy direction I'm trying to develop? And they'll be, yeah, that's great. Oh, and by the way, you're going to have to go and register for that. And then there's a danger that we have lost. And it's about trying to find that balance. So I don't think there is an atmosphere of suggesting that people are going to try and avoid this register. I thought that the comments from Professor Chari last week about the Canadian Cancer Charity, which just tries and gets as much information on the register as possible because they see it as a positive way of seeing the impact of their organisation, was interesting. So I think if that's the way the register is seen as a positive tool, I hope that's the way it would be seen. Mm.
Except there does seem to be something slightly contradictory about the bill insofar as section 44.3 says, and I'm quoting, in this section, lobbying means making a communication of any kind to a member of the parliament in relation to the member's functions. Now, that seems to me to be considerably broader.
So that's in terms of the code of conduct?
Yes.
So in terms of the code. That's intentional in that the bill is dealing with registered lobbying, and the code is able to deal with all lobbying, so that it's appropriate. The code can go wider if the Parliament seeks to. So in terms of providing guidance, so there is an intentional difference between these two things. They have a different purpose.
Just to be clear, Minister, therefore, the code of conduct would cover those people who would be eligible for voluntary registration, but may or may not have chosen to voluntary register. And the intention is that the code covers that category.
The code would cover all lobbying activities, so it would be appropriate for it to go much broader.
The three categories of lobbyists, in other words, those who are required to register, those who voluntarily choose to register, and those who do not register at all.
Yes, and the code could cover, the powers there are pretty wide in terms of how the Parliament determines to take that forward, in order to make sure that we are covering and getting the maximum amount of transparency. That's, I think, in line with the principle of complementing existing frameworks. So we have regulated lobbying, which the bill deals with, and unregulated lobbying, much of which is dealt with by other frameworks.
I understand what the bill is trying to do. But in effect, that point 3.44 is almost defining lobbying. So it would worry me that would be different from something that was elsewhere in the bill, and I just wonder whether it's something that might be looked at.
I think we're obviously happy to continue looking, but the purpose here is to say which lobbying is regulated by what is a statutory regime, and which lobbying there is guidance that the Parliament makes provisions for. And also the point is that this can tie in with MSPs, the MSP Code of Conduct and other frameworks, ministerial codes can all be tied in with that. So the guidance has been written, the bill has been written with that section in a way that it is flexible enough for the Parliament to use those powers in the way it sees fit.
I do think that paragraph needs to just, or that clause just needs to be looked at again.
We'll consider your point of view.
David, do you want to come in now?
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. It's just a small point, Minister, that I would ask you to consider and comment on if you wish. One of the exemptions is communications in, etc., cross-party groups, but quite often with cross-party groups, after a discussion, the group will actually communicate right to a minister or cabinet secretary or indeed a health board or councils and so on. So it's not just the communications within cross-party groups that we need to consider, it's the impact of that cross-party group then writing to ministers and so on. I just wonder if that needs to be broadened a wee bit to cover that point.
I mean, I guess our initial point is that this committee has, I think, recently strengthened the framework around how cross-party groups operate. So it's about balance and not duplicating other matters. But, if there was a feeling that there was something, if a minister was to come to a cross-party group, then that's obviously on the record, that's already in the public domain. So having to then, I'm not even sure who would then be registering that on the lobbyist that they've got a meeting with the minister, if the cross-party group's got a meeting with the minister, who would then register that? I'm not sure it's adding any transparency. I mean, I think that this committee has made some inroads into improving the transparency that surrounds the framework for cross-party groups in the Parliament. And I think, if you remember back to our three principles, one of them is to make sure that we're not duplicating other frameworks which are already in place and other procedures and not crossing over.
Yeah. Thanks for that. It's more. It's not so much what takes part at a cross-party group meeting. It's what might take part after that meeting, where the cross-party group picks up on an issue about, say, the number of physiotherapists that are available in the country, and then decides to write to the minister asking that maybe the convener, secretary, treasurer, or whoever, a wee delegation could meet with the minister to consider those matters.
So let me just try and understand who's meeting, I think, before we can... I'll maybe ask Al to come in a second, but let's understand who's meeting. So if it's the convener of the group that's meeting with the minister, then clearly that meeting's not covered because it's an MSP that's meeting. If it's the secretary who might be, of course, a lobbyist working for a big pharma company, let's just go to the extreme, then I'll...
I was going to say that the exception as currently drafted is looking to capture the engagements within a meeting of a cross-party group, recognising, as the Minister says, that there are separate rules in place governing the probity or activity of CPGs. The situation that you appear to be envisaging is, I mean, one, if there was a written communication on the back of a CPG as currently drafted, the bill would not capture that. That would just be, as currently, just the face-to-face meeting. If there were a face-to-face meeting, then... Neil will maybe correct me if I'm wrong, but I would assume that that meeting would be separately registrable because it was no longer made in the course of the CPG forum.
That's correct.
If it's with a lobbyist of some sort. So
the intention is that if a CPG requests a face-to-face meeting and folk who are non-MSPs meet a minister, the CPG would need to register that, register as lobbyists?
No, not the CPG.
Well, who would register? The people meeting the minister, or how would that work?
I think the exception at the moment is designed to carve out communications which take place at a meeting of the cross-party group. So if it is a communication in the course of any meeting of the cross-party group, then the intention is that is not... a trigger. If there are communications by members of that, if there are then meetings between members of that cross-party group and ministers or MSPs, then the starting, you go back to the starting point that is registrable unless any of the other exceptions.
Confirm that it would be registrable by the organisation that person represents?
But Minister, that person, whoever was delegated to meet the minister to take forward the point would be representing the cross-party group. If a cross-party group decides that there's an issue they want to pursue, then how does that... just maybe something for further consideration.
Okay. I think they're covered in terms of by the organisation, but we'll take it away and just confirm your point.
It may be just useful at this point to express a view from the chair that some cross-party groups schedule a meeting, have a meeting, but it turns out not to be quorate, and therefore, although it has all the appearance and operation as if it was a cross-party group, it would not meet the definition of being a meeting of a cross-party group. And I just put it on the record so that cross-party groups might care to note that the introduction of this bill may widen some of the implications for their meeting when they're not quorate. And I just make that point. I think it bears further examination on another occasion. But I think there's an important point for cross-party groups to note.
There's always going to be an important part of taking this forward, so that will be helpful.
Right, I think Gil.
Minister, did the government consider whether other individuals such as civil servants, parliamentary officials and senior agency staff be included in the definition in addition to MSPs and ministers?
We did consider whether there were other appropriate bodies that we would want to include, but again, it came down to coming to a right balance. So what we've gone for is to again reflect on the conclusions of reached by the committee, which was then backed up by the SPCB, who made clear to government the need to consider the impacts of any register model that might create a resource burden greater than that envisaged in the report from February. So we had to look at that very carefully. So in considering whether ministerial special advisors or MSP senior advisors, I would draw the distinction that advisors, whether they're advising MSPs or ministers, advise, whereas the decisions are ultimately made by the MSPs or the ministers. And I think that's why we think we have got the correct balance here. So any move to widen that definition of lobbyee in the bill, I think would clearly result in a greater number of registrants and returns. That may particularly be the case if the range of communication which the trigger of the bill required to register and report lobbying was expanded as well. So I think, you know, it's about trying to get a balance and a proportionate registration, but ultimately the reason for the decision was that MSPs and ministers make decisions, special advisers and MSPs, senior advisers, advise.
I just want to get a technical point out of the way. Given that the civil service is actually UK civil service, is it correct that this parliament would not have the power to legislate directly in relation to civil servants, albeit we could legislate in respect of lobbyists who are engaging with civil servants? Is that a correct and fair distinction that you would want to make clear to us?
Clearly, the civil service is reserved in terms of Schedule 5 to the Scotland Act. So, as with many things, it will come down to an application of the purpose. It's about the we would have to consider the purpose.
So, there is a virus issue which we'll not attempt to resolve here. If we were to get ourselves in the position of legislating about the civil service.
The civil service is reserved in terms of Schedule 5.
That's all right. I just wanted to get that technical point out of the way.
Gil. Purpose test.
I understand that point, although I wasn't quite aware of it until the convener raised it. However, if it's fairly certain that lobbyists do actually make inroads to or discuss matters with civil servants on behalf of the government, would in effect, if a lobbyist did, make contact and discussion with a civil servant, would the minister be required to register that because it would be a discussion that a government might make a decision based on that information? So in a way, inadvertently, in a way, they are actually lobbying the minister.
What obviously we had to do, and the conclusion of the committee was the same, was to look at where a line would be drawn. And the I think the committee's report stated, and we concurred, that face-to-face direct lobbying was of a different scale than any other types of lobbying. And we're not saying there aren't other types of lobbying, which is why the code looks at unregulated lobbying. But in terms of regulated lobbying, face-to-face, where you can see the whites of somebody's eyes, is on a different scale.
Okay. And in a similar vein, in other jurisdictions, we have a cooling-off period for people who were MSPs or maybe they were working in some capacity for the government, and there's a cooling-off period before they can effectively engage with the Parliament and the government in relation to lobbying. Had the government given any consideration to that category of people?
Yeah, I kind of, again, from the evidence last week, it sounded like Ireland had included something like this in their legislation. That may be because Ireland doesn't have another framework in place to deal with those situations. Obviously, we do. Civil servants who leave the service are covered by the business appointment rules. Again, it's a UK reserved matter, but nonetheless they are covered, which provides for the scrutiny of appointments which former Crown servants propose to take up in the first 2 years. So there's a two-year period for civil servants. Special advisers are also covered by that for the business appointment rules for civil servants, senior civil servants, sorry, senior special advisors, it's the same 2 years, and other special advisor, it's a 1 year period. So effectively, these are cooling off periods. The ministerial code also has provision for a minister leaving office being prohibited from lobbying government for 2 years, and they are also covered by the Independent Advisory Committee on Business Appointments about any appointments or employment they wish to take for up to 2 years. So while it's not in this bill, it is in the overall framework that we have, and you know, we're not, this bill is no intention of being the one piece of legislation that provides transparency and probity in Scotland. That is not its intention. Its intention is to complement the frameworks that we have in place.
I can well understand that answer coming from a government perspective and civil service perspective. I wonder if you could make any comment with regards to the concept of MSPs and folk who perhaps were never ever involved in government, but certainly were senior advisers in a political capacity and paid for by the Parliament through this, mm-hmm. the allowances system. Should they be included? Should there be a cooling off period for them?
Speaking absolutely personally, I don't think so. I think we're on a different scale there, and I think that would be disproportionate in terms of if somebody's, you can imagine somebody who's just stood for election, and you know, we're not in control of our fate in these matters. Find themselves, has done a fantastic job as an MSP for whatever party, find themselves out of work, and then we're I think that would be disproportionate.
Okay, thanks for that,
Patricia.
Sorry, I do have a question, but I'm just reflecting on what the Minister said latterly, and I have a funny feeling that the public appointments legislation restricts former MSPs and the positions
in
certain
public roles.
Exactly. It might just be worth there being a bit of a look at that to make sure there's synchronicity at least there.
I'm not personally aware of that.
I think there is.
We'll look into that. Yeah. So there may be more than
I think Patricia Ferguson is absolutely correct. There are certain public roles that there is a cooling off period for. I mean, appointment to
about to the members' experience,
boards,
in particular.
Boards and agencies, that kind of thing. But going back to my colleague Gil Patterson's earlier question about the category of people to be caught by the legislation, if that's the right word, I wondered about people who, for example, are chairs of agencies. NDPBs and the like, whether there was any consideration given to them being subject to this legislation. And also another category of parliamentarian, which is the parliamentary liaison officers, who do have quite a lot of access to ministers, presumably, but who also might be the conduit for lobbying. And it might be quite important to ensure there's transparency there.
So the Parliament liaison officers will obviously be caught as MSPs. I mean, I think the one big difference between this legislation and legislation elsewhere in these islands is that it does, again, on recommendation of your report, include MSPs as well. So parliamentary liaison officers are caught by this, so people can't use that as a back door to get into ministers. That's not possible because meetings with all MSPs are caught by the legislation. Chairs of NGOs will be caught if they are paid for in that role, and it's maybe a small number who are not paid for that role. As I think generally they would be of belonging to organisations which are of such a size that the organisation will already be registered, so voluntarily adding the information for a senior unpaid person would not be onerous and could, I think, be encouraged.
Okay. I have to say I'm not convinced about the PLO issue because I think they have a very specific role over and above their role as an MSP. And in a sense, it's the same argument we make for including ministers as ministers rather than as MSPs only, because we recognise that there is a specific role there. And I would be very anxious that if they were not covered by the legislation, that lobbyists might see them as almost fair game, as a conduit to ministers.
That would certainly not be the intention, but what we'll do is go away and just check to make sure that we haven't inadvertently created a backdoor to lobbying, which is not the intention. I don't think it is, because I think the intention is that all MSPs are covered, so that would include parliamentary liaison officers. But let us take that away. Sorry, Minister,
I'm not suggesting it doesn't include PLOs as MSPs.
Yeah, but in their capacity as PLOs, I understand your question. Let us just take that away and make sure that we haven't missed something.
Thank you.
Right, Minister, if we move on to the thresholds and triggers, essentially they require there to be a regulated lobbying, requires there to be payment to the person who's undertaking the lobbying, or more broadly, reward to the person who's undertaking the lobbying. What consideration did you give to other definitions, and why did you end up with that particular definition?
Well, first of all, we wanted a level playing field so that everyone was treated equally. So it was about finding that mechanism. So therefore, there were two, I think, serious possibilities in terms of taking that one forward. One was the committee's preference in terms of a threshold, and the other was the idea that paid lobbying provided a threshold. And we considered both very seriously. We were concerned that having a threshold in terms of a number of meetings over a year would provide a significant potential loophole where an organisation could manage the number of meetings in order to not trigger that threshold. And even if there was no intent to not trigger the threshold or to avoid, it could fail to register significant acts of lobbying. So, you know, you could potentially have one meeting which is of great significance, would not require to be registered, and I think that would be that was our concern. We did, of course, because consult on both proposals in terms of taking it forward. I think both proposals were trying to achieve the same thing in terms of finding a proportionate way forward where we weren't catching minor acts of lobbying and also not missing significant lobbying. The consultation was overwhelmingly in support of the paid lobbying being the test.
Now, when we look at NGOs, and big NGOs in particular, who will employ people, part of whose duties are to lobby, those individuals are therefore paid and caught by the definition. But equally, there will be large numbers. I don't choose them for any particular reason, but the RSPB has six figures of numbers, I think, if I recall correctly, maybe even over a million. And, of course, the individual members who are not paid to lobby can nonetheless be a very significant part of the lobbying activity, but would appear not to be their activity, even though acting on behalf of that organisation, appear not to be caught. That's a correct understanding, and do you think that's the right way of dealing with it?
I absolutely do think it's the right thing. I don't think it matters what somebody's job description is, so let's be clear, if RSPB employs somebody with a different, that doesn't have the title lobbying and yet they're lobbying, then they are caught, and so they should be. However, I do not think it is correct that a member of the public who happens to be a member of the RSPB, who wants to engage with their MSP on an issue that the RSPB is lobbying, so that they should be caught. So whether it's members of the RSPB, members of the Boys Brigade wanting to lobby on behalf of their organisations, I think it's correct that this bill does not catch those individuals. So I think
was seeking, Minister, perhaps to take it to a slightly different domain, not specifically constituent on behalf of RSPB engaging with their own MSP,
but
coming to Parliament engaging with a range of MSPs, many of whom don't represent them.
And again, I think for those individuals, I don't think they should see any hurdle in terms of engaging with the Parliament with government. I think that is exactly the sort of people we want to make sure that we are not putting any barriers in place of. Last week, Neil Findlay raised, I thought, quite a useful example in terms of organisations being involved in terms of the equal marriage debate. So there was two organisations, and I think, as Neil pointed out, that both of those organisations had strongly held views. They both would have been caught in terms of their organised lobbying. They both had people who were paid to be lobbying, and those people would correctly have been caught. It would have been, I think, it would be wrong if we were to have a bill which would then make it difficult for the folk who were supporters of both of those campaigns to engage with MSPs, ministers, to engage in the debate that we had, and to any barrier of those individuals, I think would be wrong. So, this is exactly the sort of people we want to make sure that we're not catching.
But nonetheless, Minister, it's the organisation that is the registrant, not the individuals. The case is being made to us that all activity that is on behalf of that organisation, which is requires because it undertakes regulated lobbying activity, all activity that falls under that should be caught by the register, notwithstanding the fact that some of that will be undertaken by people who do not receive any reward for doing it. And I think I'd be interested to hear your reasoning for that.
I feel quite strongly that these people should not be caught. I think there's a number of reasons. In sticking with Neil's topic, during that campaign, obviously I had a particular position, but I engaged with a large number of constituents. I wouldn't think the two organisations will have known who engaged with me. So I think we would be putting in place a complexity that I think would be very difficult for us to manage. I think we'd have a strong potential for the organisation to say, you can't do that unless you let us know first. Well, I don't think anyone should have to get permission to engage either with the democratic process. So I think there will be that lobby. That's the lobbying we want to encourage. And I don't think we should shy away from the fact of using the word lobbying for that type of activity, because I think it's what it is, and it's appropriate, and it's to be welcomed.
That's helpful to get that on the record, Minister. Thank you. The other thing that I think there is a bit of a head of steam among some people out there, and which probably the majority of the public might feel would be an appropriate trigger, is the actual level of expenditure that's undertaken. And what consideration did you give to whether that could be used as a trigger, and why you ended up dismissing it?
I think using the level of expenditure as a trigger would have been pretty easy for third-party lobbyists, for consultant lobbyists. They will have a line, and they'll know exactly how much they spent on a particular campaign, so it would be dead easy for them. It would be probably slightly more difficult for in-house lobbying of big organisations, and it would potentially be quite onerous on some smaller organisations, and I'm not actually sure it would be terribly, terribly helpful.
So really your focus, Minister, is on the activity of lobbying and whether there is a reward associated with undertaking that activity, and you're seeking to argue to us that that is a more clear-cut and unambiguous definition than simply financial.
In order to find a regime which is simple to understand, I think the two methods, the one in terms of the number of meetings which was suggested by the committee or paid, would both, I think, work in terms of that test.
You're also suggesting the financial test might bear disproportionately on those middle-ranking organisations, the small ones who are not paying at all.
I think potentially it would impact on smaller. It would bizarrely be easiest for the consultant organisations, because they won't have to do any work to do that. They will know exactly how much money they have spent on a campaign.
But nonetheless, do you recognise that
the public might have a perfectly reasonable interest in, just for the sake of argument, how much the drinks industry is spending to resist the agreed policy we have in this Parliament of minimum pricing, just to choose one example.
So the bill, obviously, if we're sticking with the trigger as is, the bill does allow for Parliament, as after consideration, I would have thought, to extend the details which are on the register. So the bill would provide a framework whereby a future committee could say that they felt that is information which the clerks were in a position to register and to maintain the system which had that information. We need to make sure we have a system that works and that it was at a time that it's proportionate and useful to the public. But all those considerations would, I think, need to be taken into account. But we have, within the framework of the bill, provided the power for the scope to be extended in that way, in terms of the information which is registered.
Now, just finally, perhaps, there are quite a lot of lobbying organisations that are in themselves charities and therefore already regulated by OSCO. Is this creating, in a sense, a dual registration for such bodies,
It doesn't. Oscar's role is very, very different to what this bill is. And it would be important for us to make sure that there wasn't a duplication, but there certainly is no duplication in terms of the role of Oscar and what this bill is trying to achieve.
Okay, Patricia.
Thank you. I wanted to go on, Minister, to talk about the content of the register in a wee bit more detail. And particularly reflecting on the discussions we had in the round table last week, and there were some suggestions about other things that should be included. For example, expenditure again was seen as being quite an important thing to reflect the level of concern, if you like, that an organisation might have in an issue. And there were suggestions that banding might be quite helpful, so that you would have a band that you could indicate to help to protect commercial confidentiality. But another suggestion was also around the employment history of lobbyists, so that, you know, because sometimes it's not the seniority or the position of the person in the organisation that matters, it's actually the contacts they've got as a result of previous activity. So I wondered about those and any other issues that you had thought about.
Section 15 powers are designed to offer the Parliament full flexibility over the operational aspects of the register, so it would be within the Parliament's powers, and again to stress the Parliament, not government, to change what is required to be there. I think Parliament would have thought want to do that very carefully, making sure that we weren't putting an overly onerous burden on, which would then provide a block to engagement with the democratic process. So I think that would want to be done, taken forward carefully. But we have provided the power to allow that to be added. So I mean, this bill is designed to provide a framework which is flexible and can evolve going forward as the Parliament sees fit.
Okay. One of the other issues we discussed last week was around the idea of a six-monthly return. And there were actually a variety of views expressed about that. I think most of those who were what we would understand normally by the term lobbyists already have systems in place that allow them to record contacts, because that's what they're about and that's very important to them. And there were suggestions that we should have maybe once a year registration rather than every 6 months. There were others who thought it should almost be like a rolling register. I just wondered why 6 months was the figure that was arrived at.
We had to find a figure that was balanced, but the reason for a rolling 6 months rather than a six-month cut-off, so on a set date, I think a census day almost. That if there was a census day, I think that would put an unnecessary burden on the Parliament in terms of all that information coming in at one time, whereas if it's people do it at their own time, it will be spread out over the year, and hopefully that will be able to be managed more easily by the Parliament. So that was the main reason for I listened last week, but I could see how that might be helpful to the organisations, but I think it might put a burden on the Parliament that doesn't actually help too much.
Can I just be clear? It's not the intention that the bill prevents, where the registrant thinks it's appropriate to do so, an early update.
No, of course not. That's fine.
That's helpful. And we also discussed the information about the lobbying activity itself. And as I understand it, at the moment, we talk about the purpose of the lobbying. And there was a suggestion made that perhaps that needs to be a little bit more specific and perhaps talk about the outcome that the lobbyist hopes to achieve, which is perhaps a subtle difference, but perhaps an important subtle difference.
Again, I think the bill is written in a way that that could be added. But Neil, do you want to just...
You're absolutely right. The way the bill is framed at the moment, one of the bits of information that has to be provided is information about the purpose of the lobbying. There are different formulations in other legislation that refer to purpose and outcome. Purpose can be construed fairly broadly. There is, again, the ability for Parliament to issue guidance about the operation of the regime, and which can add colour, if I put it that way, to the provisions of the bill. But certainly at the moment, it is the purpose of the lobbying is the way that the legislation is framed.
Okay, thank you.
But also, just to be clear, section 15 would allow us to prescribe not simply in guidance. Yeah.
Indeed.
Yeah. Yes.
Sorry.
Just
by my direction.
The Section 15 power allows it gives Parliament the power by resolution. To change bits of the framework, including the bit of the framework that prescribes what information has to be provided.
Yes, and that goes beyond mere guidance.
Indeed.
Yes, I just wanted to be clear technically on that one. I think we're back to Cameron now. Flexibility.
Yes, I've got it here. I was concerned about the flexibility of the lobbying bill because it was. There are no powers to alter the provisions of it in the flexibility. Was this like coming back to it and relating to the exclusions of the lobbying bill? And I wondered how you would think of that, because I was concerned about the flexibility of it. Because there's some, I think there's provisions to alter things on it, but not enough.
So what we've tried to do is to give maximum powers in terms of the operation of the bill, but the core principles, our view is perhaps should be decided as the bill goes through, and if there was a major change to the core principles, then that would require to and could appropriately come back with it to primary legislation.
Do you mean it's like a sort of what we used to call a sunset clause or something?
Well, no, it's simply saying that here are things which it's appropriate in terms of the operation of the framework that the bill that we're bringing forward, that the Parliament will want to consider more regularly, I think. And I think a committee similar to this committee would probably want to look at how the bill is working and how the registration scheme is working to see whether we've got it right. If we're changing the basis of who has to register, that's more significant, and that would, I think, more rightly be something that the Parliament would want to look at in terms of future bill.
And who would have the responsibility for lodging that?
In terms of a bill, that would a bill would be whoever sought to bring forward a bill, so it could be a committee bill. In terms of the changes to the powers,
the operational powers.
That will be one of the things that the Parliament needs to set out in standing orders. It may very well be this committee would be the likely committee you would expect standing orders to give that provision to, in a similar way that this committee looks at the other standing orders, such as members' interest statute. So, I think obviously it's for Parliament to decide how to take them. So that's how we bit coy in saying definite, because it's for Parliament to decide how to take that forward. But I would have thought it would be a standing order change which would give that role to this committee. I would have thought.
Helpful to say there's some early consideration being given by the clerks to what standing orders changes might be and code of conduct and a range of things that are provided under the bill. And I think the expectation at the moment, at least, is that it would be for this committee.
or its successors to bring forward these matters in due course, but for Parliament to approve or reject, of course.
Yes, sorry. Do you think that Parliament could be lobbied to get this changed by lobbyists, to get this thing changed?
Well, if it, and it would be recorded.
Yes, of course.
It could be recorded. One of the great things about this committee, though, and I would imagine it's been the same for its predecessors and the committees that follow, is that I think you would be quite resistant to such actions, and you'll base your decisions on the evidence that you see. So,
okay. Thank you.
Patricia?
I didn't have anything under.
No, I'm thinking of what was saying in enforcement, I think. Yes, David, sorry, I beg your pardon. Right, is it Gil?
No, it's David. David, was going to
David. Right, come on then.
I passed you a note.
Sorry?
Thanks, convener. I just want to pick up on the oversight and enforcement issues. We heard from the commissioner that he had some concerns about that, and he outlined a sort of nightmare scenario where he would have to be reporting back, you know, on numerous occasions. And it's all to do as well with the duty that he has to report any criminal matter to the Procurator Fiscal. And the policy memorandum is saying that this is a light touch approach, educative, etc. But if someone reports to the commissioner before the clerks, for instance, have had a chance to deal with something, then we're automatically into this situation where he has to put it to the PF and so on. And I just wonder if you can comment on those concerns.
First of all, I think it is very important that we do have that legal basis to the bill. Without that, it would be, I think, difficult for clerks to do their job in terms of education and getting people to register properly. But you know, the purpose here is really absolutely for an educative and light touch regime. There's no requirement in the law for the commissioner to report in the bill for the commissioner to report to the Procurator Fiscal. That is not in, and it's not the intention. Al, do you want to give a little bit more of a
Yeah. There's, I mean, again, under the members' interests, or more correctly, the old Scottish Parliamentary Standards Commissioner legislation, the directions could be brought forward, and I understand there was one brought forward in that context with regard to how the Commissioner should handle certain matters, and if it came to his attention that in his eyes there was reason to do so, then he could report matters, refer matters to the Procurator Fiscal and await a decision as to whether a prosecution was required. Reflecting on the fact that this is meant to be a light touch regime, we purposely did not include on the face of the bill any such requirement. However, under Section 31 as drafted, there is the potential for a mirroring provision to what other statutes have. So we could have a direction-making power. Parliament could choose to direct the Commissioner to act in a similar way. But again, we thought in this particular statutory framework that was not appropriate. And again, you know, I do take the point about members of the public, as with any offences, it would be open to members of the public to approach the police or whoever and seek to take forward prosecutions or indeed for a point one to put complaints to the commissioner. Again, on that same basis, a direction, we've had the discussions over the issue about whether the commissioner would be unduly caught up with matters of lesser significance which didn't warrant investigation but were still issues as regards the integrity of the registrable information. And that, again, we would suggest that the power under Section 31 could be used for the Parliament to direct the Commissioner on how to act in cases such as that, so that potentially such issues could be referred back for consideration by the clerk.
So the intention would be that pretty clear guidance and direction will be given to the Commissioner to ensure that trivial matters don't end up before the Fiscal with all the delays, etc. So the Commissioner will very clearly know and understand what he is able to do and putting those sort of things back to the clerks. Is that what you're telling me?
Yeah, there's no requirement for him to report to the fiscal.
But equally, Minister, it will be a matter for perhaps putting on some slightly formal basis the relationship between the Commissioner and the Lord Advocate as the head of the Prosecution Service. Because, of course, it's not wholly with... It will depend on the Lord Advocate's view of what's appropriate in some instances as well.
We are creating a criminal offence here, so there does have to be clarity there. But Neil, do you want to add a little bit more?
Clearly, there will be a need to manage the relationship between the Procurator Fiscal Service and the role of the Commissioner. But I would agree with what the Minister and Al have said. The bill confers functions.
Yeah.
Gives the Commissioner a particular role, and that is his role. There's no requirement for things to be escalated. No requirement for things to be escalated by him. And equally, there is the facility for Parliament to issue directions to the Commissioner in whatever terms Parliament sees fit. But one particular direction could be issued, particular type of direction that could be issued would be to allow the Commissioner to refer matters back to the clerk to be looked at in the first instance.
But there's no question about directing the Lord Advocate as to what his attitude might be.
The power that...
It's self-evident. Yes. That's fine. Now, Patricia wants to ask something about another matter.
No. Sorry, I thought Gil was still to come in.
No,
you're fine. Sorry. Okay. Sorry for the confusion. Minister, we took evidence earlier this morning from the Commissioner, which was very interesting, and one of the points he made was that one of the communications that's specifically excluded in Schedule 1 is journalism. I think his feeling was that that was a very broad definition. And he made what I think is quite a valid point in that there are different forms of journalism. There are house magazines, for example, or trade magazines that maybe use their publications as lobbying. And he was questioning us as to whether or not that was really as helpful a definition as it might be.
Obviously, one of the points to note is obviously that the product of journalists tends to be very much in the public domain. But in terms of the definition, Neil, again, do you want to?
Indeed, the definition, the exception is communications. Communications for the purposes of journalism. We have thought about that. The explanatory notes for that particular exception, paragraph 18 of the explanatory notes. Refer to particular case law where the legal concept of journalism is discussed. A case called Commissioner of the Metropolis against Times Newspapers Limited, and there is a discussion of what journalism in the concept of journalism in law, and it is that we're trying to get at in framing this definition.
So it will probably be helpful at some stage as the bill goes through to make sure we have appropriate comments on the record that could be referred to by courts at a later date to help to understand our intention? Or would you perhaps consider whether the definition, which is just quite straightforward in the schedule at the moment, might you look at that again? Because I think Patricia Ferguson has a reasonable point.
What we'll look at to make sure that in legal terms, the definition we have, it's doing exactly what we expect it to do and not doing something else.
Okay. Finally, I've received a bit of correspondence from the Finance Committee that appears to be a bit of a discrepancy between what the financial memorandum says, the SPCB and the Commissioner. I wonder if the Minister might care to comment on that.
Is that in the
estimates for costs?
He's not challenging the cost, though, is he?
Well, let me just quote from Mr. Gibson, Kenny Gibson, the convener of the Finance Committee's letter. The financial memorandum says the financial memorandum accurately reflects the indicative costs and assumptions provided by Parliament, which the
Scottish Parliament corporate body believes to be reasonable outcome. However, submission draws the committee's attention to the bill's potential cost applications for the Commissioner. On the basis of figures provided by the Commissioner, the financial memorandum estimates he would incur additional costs between zero in the case of no investigation, 70,000 in the case of 10 complex. But then the financial memorandum goes on to say the Commissioner does, however, believe any additional investigations arising from the result of the bill can be absorbed within his existing resource. But the corporate body says, says otherwise, that essentially there will be extra costs for the Commissioner. And I just wondered if you...
So the memorandum, of course, does state what the extra cost would be, zero upwards, depending on the number of cases. But there was, I think we need to, it's probably worth putting on the record, there was a misunderstanding on our part of what the Commissioner had meant in terms of absorbing that. And I think we accept what the Commissioner is saying, that those costs, which the Finance Committee are saying are accurate, are additional costs not.
So do I take that we'll see a restatement of the financial memorandum at some point, preferably before Parliament?
I think the figures in the memorandum are
the figures are correct, but the commentary needs adjusting. Is that what we're hearing?
We can investigate what, and you know, happy to put on record as the Minister has said that there's been a misunderstanding, and I think I'm sort of happy that what arose in the financial memorandum, I think, was a confusion around the Commissioner's explanation to myself and colleagues as to whether lobbying complaints in themselves would amount to were capable of absorption, or was it the fact that these additional functions on top of what we understood to be other enhancements to the Commissioner's remit would at some point in the future require, you know, could no longer be absorbed. So as the Minister says, very happy to accept that that is that was a misrepresentation in the memorandum, and we'll look to see what we
can I seek a commitment from the Minister that by the time Parliament gets to considering any financial resolution on this matter, and I'm not sure there will require to be one, but just presuming there might be, that we perhaps have a version of the financial memorandum before Parliament, which no member on this basis will wish to challenge.
I mean, I think we are today accepting the Commissioner's position and putting that on the record, so that it's
well
on the record.
I'm really just maybe taking it just a notch further, Minister, and perhaps asking you consider reissuing the financial memorandum.
Check what the process is.
I mean, I hear you've put it on the record now, but I suspect that it'd be helpful.
We'll just check what the process is for that.
Yes, that's fine. Now, I think we've covered the ground we wanted to cover. Has anyone got any other further matters? Have you any concluding remarks, Minister? Any issues we haven't covered you wish to draw to
our attention? No, thank you very much. And obviously, we appreciate the way we've taken this forward. And I think we're moving forward in the most appropriate way on a bill, which is, as I said at the start, largely parliamentary in its nature. So it's appropriate that we continue to listen to this committee and as the bill moves through the Parliament.
Thank you, Minister. Mr. Gibson and Mr. MacLeod, for attending and being helpful in your answers. We now move into private session.